Welcome, everybody, and welcome, Josie, again to Bangalore and the Bangalore Lit Fest. We are very happy to have you so that we can interrogate you, pull out your fingernails, torture you, and make you confess the truth. But, you know, let me just start with a story. I see some people with the Josie's T-shirt, you know, the silent coup. Gentlemen, could you just stand up and show yourself? Just to tell you what, look at the fan following this man has. Yeah, your fingers are safe. So let me just tell you a story. There's this president of the Republic of Make-Believe. The president of the Republic of Make-Believe had a problem. He says, look, you know, there's this beautiful lake which I have in my capital city. It's my private lake. People are throwing dead bodies inside. Somebody comes and says, sir, it's not your lake. I mean, it's a lake, but yeah. But he says, yeah, there are dead bodies being thrown inside the lake. We have to do something. And then suddenly one of those palace insiders comes and says, sir, your great-great-grandfather, when he was president, made a rule which allows us to ban the disposal of dead bodies. But he did it for some other reason. You know, there was some crime being conducted. People were disposing of the evidence. So this was done to prevent people from disposing of, you know, hiding evidence. But that law exists. You can use it. So the president of Make-Believe, what he says is, let's do this. So they ban the disposal of dead bodies. In no form can a corpse be disposed of. You can't bury, you can't burn, you can't throw it into the lake. You can't do anything. So this goes on. 1-2 years later, there's a problem. You know, there's a particular political guy who's giving trouble to this president. And the president says, I have to fix this guy. The chamberlain says, sir, I'll fix it. They go to the guy's house and they look here and there. They look in the cupboard and there's a skeleton. So there's a skeleton in your cupboard. You must have committed a crime. So you go. Because they couldn't catch him on any other ground. So there was a skeleton. Then they realize that this is an interesting thing. So there's a newspaper editor called the Bindu. And the Bindu was writing very bad articles about the government. So the chamberlain sends the policeman, say, go to the editor's house and look in his cupboard. They go into the editor's house, they look in the cupboard, and what do they find? Skeletons. You have a skeleton in your cupboard. So the next week onwards, the Bindu starts being very friendly to the government. Then they go to the industrialist. You know, the industrialists have been making very bad noise about, you know, economic policy. The budget has been getting 4 out of 10, 5 out of 10. Go to his house. They go to the industrialist's house, look in the cupboard. What do they find? What do they find? Skeletons. Go inside. Next time the budget is out, what do the industrialists say? How much do they give to the budget? 10 out of 10. All this happens, you're familiar. And then finally what happens is they come to a think tank. You know, there's a guy who runs a think tank. You know, he writes about public policy, writes columns in newspapers. He's writing some things which are irritating the government. Send the police to his house, look in his cupboard, they find a skeleton. And then the think tank becomes quiet. He stops writing sharp pieces against the government. This is the story of the Republic of Make-Believe. Who is to be blamed here? Whose fault is it that we've ended up in this kind of a situation? Is it the policeman who arrests people for having skeletons in the cupboard? Is it the people like the editor, the industrialist, the intellectual who self-censor themselves because they have skeletons in the cupboard? Is it because of this king or this president in this case, the president who ordered that this law about disposal of the dead should be enforced? Whose fault is it? Keep that at the back of your mind as we go through this conversation. Now, It is, having set this story and set this stage, there is no doubt that the balance of power between the government official and the state has gone massively askew in our country, not in make-believe here, right? It is massively askew because, you know, as long as there's a balance, there's a presumption that, you know, the citizen has recourse to quick justice and exoneration, there is some balance. But when you don't have that, when the wheels of justice, when they move at all, are rusty, creaky, and not entirely, free of manufacturing defects, someone can arrest you, and by the time you're exonerated, it's too late. You might lose 5-10 years of your life. You might lose a lot of mental peace and your money and opportunities and so on. So the fear of that keeps a lot of us in check. But it's also a travesty that this imbalance exists. Why it exists? What should we do to fix this? We'll talk about that later. I just want to make another counterpoint. And that's to do with people who work in the area of intelligence, security, the agencies conceptually. I'm not talking about any particular intelligence agency or a particular security force. But these people operate at the twilight zone of constitutional and non-constitutional. The external intelligence agencies, for example, you cannot bind them to constitutional things because they're operating outside the frontiers of India, you know, the physical frontiers of India, as well as the constitutional frontiers of India. You know, they have to perforce operate. That is why we have an intelligence agency which is set up to do these kind of things so that you and I don't have to do it. Similarly, parts of the armed forces, they are trained to operate in, you know, using lethal force in certain areas, which is necessary. If you don't give them that kind of leeway, you can't secure yourself. Domestic police, domestic intelligence is a different story. They have to operate within the constraints of the law and the constitution. But some leeway is necessary. It is expected. You cannot have a democratic state without having extremely sharp attack dogs who attack the enemies of the state or the enemies of the constitution at the margin. But what happens when this system goes askew? And that is the conversation we'll try and have today. My job here is to pull out Josie's fingernails one by one, slowly, such that he screams. But before that, I'll be nice to him. Right? Josie, this book, which this is a second book on, I think it's like a sequel to your first book. Can you tell us what made you write this book? And what was the process of writing this book? Because here you're dealing with people who have done extremely questionable things. Maybe there are people who worked at the, you know, borderlines of what is moral and immoral, legal and illegal, constitutional and illegal. You still have to talk to them and write about it and live to see the next day. How was this process? We'll talk about the process, then we'll talk about the stories, and then we'll get into other areas.
Yeah, thank you. And I'm happy that our government has not banned burial of bodies. So otherwise, in COVID season, I would have been forced to keep a few in my cupboard. Because I lost many of my neighbors. I've been a mainstream beat reporter covering defense, intelligence, etc. for more than 20 years. And I also have a background in military because I came from Chinese school. So I've been reporting on them. I've had very intimate knowledge of them. And there are a lot of good people like Ms. Arni and others in the system who are honest to the constitution and who believe that you don't need to go to the toilet too much and operate. So I had a vast network of friends in the agencies, police, everywhere. So I'm an insider. But while I've been an insider, one thing I was very clear where I would, my first point of difference of opinion with you is that I believe that our constitution provides for all kinds of operations to secure the nation state, whether they operate within India or abroad. And the constitution also provides for corrections, for mistakes, genuine mistakes to be dealt with, our laws. But what surprised me and what kept making me angry over the years was that a large number of the officials who are supposed to be protecting the constitution, holding up the human rights, looking after our welfare, they had privatized and misinterpreted the entire constitutional architecture. And they were doing two things. Primarily, they were benefiting themselves in terms of power or money. Power, you know, when you have the leverage to misuse power, it has got a lot of implications. For example, you know, if I'm a joint secretary, joint director in an intelligence bureau in Delhi, and I like a particular tandoori chicken from a particular restaurant on Friday night, I can get it home delivered. That from there it begins.
We use Swiggy in Bangalore.
That's you, the common people. This is VIP deliveries, you know. So it begins with there. But what was retail through the 90s and 2000s became a wholesale system being misused by the political leadership since Modi coming into power. I'm saying this because I was a reporter when Narasimha Rao was the prime minister. And Narasimha Rao, actually, I would say, was the last prime minister who comprehensively misused the agencies to create narratives, to intimidate, to bully people, etc. And he made that famous statement, "Low is above, you know, how much or high you are, low is above you." But he used it. After that, I mean, we were seeing an era of the coalition governments actually provided a lot of constitutional accountability because the government was weak. They were not misusing to the extent that we expected. Corruptions were not at the scale because these many of the ministers came from small towns and, you know, were in national level for the first time, you know, testing power. Their ambitions were very low. And then we had Vajpayee government. For all its ills, Vajpayee himself carried a lot of great Nehruvian, Gandhian values into the governance. There have been faults with all governments, but and Manmohan Singh government came in and ushered in truly, I think, India's biggest transparency revolution in governance, right to information, right to education, you know, and moved files to archives, you know, all kinds of things he did. And the first term of UPA, I rate as probably the best government I've covered. Second term, as you know, went into a toss, corruption, because obviously they were also slaves of coalition politics. And he closed his eyes, he and Sonia Gandhi closed their eyes to a lot of corruption and etc. And Congress as a party, as you know, it has everyone from communal to the corrupt, you know, it's a typical Indian party. But even then, the misuse of power by the police, intelligence, etc. were bothering me because after 9-11, after Kandahar hijack and then 9-11, Indian agencies went berserk because they were humiliated in Kandahar, as you know, Kandahar hijack, 99. I mean, you know, being forced to send three of your most dreaded terrorists with your foreign minister to Afghanistan. And I mean, I think it's a separate private conversation sometime about who in the world decided that the foreign minister should fly with the terrorists is separate. But it was a very humiliating moment. After that, you see a pattern of fake encounters in Delhi and surroundings. And late 90s in Kashmir, you see the fake encounters, unquestionable actions by the agencies, etc., picking up. But all of it were limited to largely to individual officials, their search for glory, shortcut to success, winning medals, etc. And by the end of the last decade, meaning 2010, 11, and 12, if you see, the Indian agencies were actually, especially the white-collar investigation agencies, were picking pace and they were taking on the mighty and they were acting on stories done by people like us. And that's when I started, I was finishing my Feast of Vultures, the previous book about intermediaries and corruption. I thought corruption was the biggest challenge to Indian democracy and I wrote the book like a fool. And that is when Modi came to power. And I was not aware of the Gujarat fake encounters, etc. But I didn't realize that that here is a government, a politician, a prime minister who has so internalized the capabilities of Indian non-military establishment, security establishment, and their power. And he draws a lot of it from Indira Gandhi, I would presume, to subvert democracy, to intimidate opposition, to completely silence the mainstream media, and get the industrialists to give the ranking that you want. that he was a master in it. And that is when I said, look, this needs to be recorded. And I know so much of it. And I said, it would be foolish and academically very dishonest if I were to put all the blame on Modi, because there is a history back. So I went back to the emergency era to see what was the Shah Commission findings on and what is the actions. And as you know, many of the villains of emergency, the bureaucratic police villains of emergency, many of them went on to have great careers. Very, very few people lost out. And the best example being Jagmohan, who was in Delhi leading the demolitions for Sanjay Gandhi. Strangely, he became a BJP minister. The BJP was a victim of the BJP. Jansang was a victim of emergency. They went on to make him a minister. I have never understood that logic of it. Adwani sitting across Jagmohan in a cabinet meeting with Vajpayee. But what we began to see after 2014 is the darkest phase of politically, people have got power, and again, power achievement of power in this country through first past the post system is a very seriously questionable issue, because I don't think it's representative, and I think it's a worst form of elections for a country like India. So you win an election because you won election by our terms, you get power, and then you go in a very organized mafia style operation to do everything that you want, primarily to silence any criticism of you. And if not for the farmers' protest, and if not for some of their own foolishness, like the way they implemented GST and demonetization, I think by now we could have been easily slipping into a state of elected autocracy in every which way. And some of the rankings have already been hinting at that. So that's when I said that I know that world, I need to write about it. And it doesn't care if people that I'm going to name know me. It doesn't matter if some of them stop talking to me, but I said, it's my job. So if you see, I've named a lot of people and some of them have actually not spoken to me after I wrote the book. That's okay with me.
I think the argument you're making is that the security apparatus is being used for partisan political purposes. Is that the broad argument?
And the agencies and officials who are willing to play the partisan politics actually end up benefiting. That is why everyone who played questionable roles in Gujarat under Modi are today Delhi Police Commissioner, NIA Chief, CAG. I mean, look at it there. All of them, indicted or with very serious question mark over their conduct, are running your constitutional and other important institutions. So both the ways.
So the first argument is, security apparatus is being used for partisan political purposes. Related argument is that those who do this, contravening their constitutional duties, are rewarded in terms of benefits of the system. Right? They could get that. That's the argument. Now, is it that this, and the third part of this, the second argument is, you said this is accelerated since 2014 after Modi ji became prime minister. Is this because of what Modi ji and his party are doing? Or is it because that in the last 10 to 15 years, we have extraordinarily different and deeper ways of looking at and finding out these things happening? Is it because not transparency? I'm not talking about governmental transparency. I'm talking about media transparency. It's much harder to hide the fact that you're doing this today than it was in Narasimha Rao's time, for example.
Governance transparency, we better not talk about it because...
Yeah, that we know.
Yeah, Modi came in and pulled an iron curtain, screwed with RTA, whatever, you know. You asked me if...
Is it because now we can see a lot more of what's happening? You know, during Narasimha Rao's time, I remember that time, something happens, I have to read it in the Indian Express or the Hindu, and yeah. You know, and Doordarshan doesn't tell me much about it. Yeah. But today, I can find out because Josie is tweeting about it.
Yeah, that is, see, social media is playing a very important role in bringing a lot of transparency and bringing up a lot of topics which otherwise the biases of mainstream media would have suppressed. That is true. But the algorithmic biases of social media is also playing a role in the other way, in the negative way. Yes, there is some amount of transparency, but when I was writing my book, I did not get much help from the what we call the transparency wave that social media has unleashed. I had to stick to court documents. I had to stick to official or secret notes, documents, etc. Because I was writing about very powerful people and serious stuff. So I did not fail. Mine came from more from my personal networks and journalistic contacts, etc. Yes, the social media is helping spread the word about injustice better, but the social media is also playing to what we were earlier talking, to put the injustice into a binary and make it right versus the left or the BJP versus the rest. So that's also, so social media in this way is actually more dangerous to society than helpful, is my theory, because the way online violence is transferring into offline is, I mean, it's unbelievable, right? So yeah, that's my answer. If I don't know if I've answered your question.
Yeah, thanks. So yeah, I'm with you on that. I've written about how social media is an existential threat to civilization. But let me just take a step back, because your book is also about the history of the deep state. Does anybody know? I mean, I think the gentleman here should be silent on this, not answer this. But does anybody know which year the precursor or the earliest intelligence bureau, when it was created, the founding of the progenitor of the intelligence bureau, which year? You know, there's an intelligence bureau on Sardar Patel Mark, right? Okay. So it was created in some year, some during somebody's, does anybody have a answer? Okay, somebody wants to make a wild guess. 50s, 70s, 60s, 47, 50s going once, 100 years ago going once, colonial going once, which year? There are two answers. The first answer is 1835, when the Thuggee Department was set up under Sleeman, right? This was the first security apparatus set up by the colonial British regime, East India Company at that time, to go after the thugs. You know, they were transnational gangs of criminals, so they set up the Thuggee Department in 1835, and that led to the creation of departments within the police system, which were in charge of looking at investigation, intelligence, spying, and so on. But the actual progenitor of the Intelligence Bureau was created in the year 1887. What is interesting about the year 1887? I mean, those of you who are old enough to remember that childhood memories. That's right, sir. The Indian National Congress was created in 1885. And the Intelligence Bureau was created in 1887. That is not a coincidence. The purpose of the Intelligence Bureau since its inception was to keep an eye on political opponents of the regime in power. So the British were ruling, and these uppity Indians were setting up something to fight for freedom, etc. And they wanted to keep an eye on various political leaders, intellectuals, businessmen, to see what is happening in the nationalist movement. So during the Swadeshi movement of 1905 and so on, there was massive amount of surveillance. So the Intelligence Bureau, the DNA of the Intelligence Bureau is not to go and catch, criminals and other kind of security threats, but internal security threats to the regime in power. And that time it was a colonial regime. You would have expected that in 1947, when the Republic and India becomes free, and in 1950, when India becomes a republic, that you would throw out these things, right? You can't have a Republic of India which says the political leader should have an insight into what the opposition leaders of the country are doing. Some of the opposition leaders might be Maoists, some of them might be Naxals, some of them might be extremists of other kinds, but others are just genuine politicians. The Intelligence Bureau still survived. 1950 to 1964 marks the longest period there was a director of the Intelligence Bureau. This is Mr. B.N. Malik, who used to report directly to Jawaharlal Nehru. Those of us who remember US history more than Indian history know of this figure called J. Edgar Hoover, who was an FBI chief and was a power to himself, would control presidents. B.N. Malik was, I think, served longer than Hoover, or probably around the same. Hoover was 17 years? More than that? Okay. Yeah, so B.N. Malik, 14 years, longer than any civil servant can hope for. Right? And in the 60s, there was a chief minister of Gujarat who writes to the Home Ministry and says, you know, the intelligence bureau guys in Gujarat are keeping an eye on Congress politicians also. Is this allowed? And the Home Ministry says, yes, it's allowed. Right? So what I'm saying is that we have an apparatus called the intelligence bureau whose primary role is political intelligence. Of course, they also do wonderful things. I have friends in the bureau who do extremely important things at risk to their life. But political intelligence is part of their mandate, regardless of whether it's stated or not. Now, it comes to the second story. Do you know what law governs the Intelligence Bureau? I mean, the TRAI is regulated by the Telecoms Act. The RBI, I think there's an RBI Act and so on. What Act of Parliament governs the Intelligence Bureau? Anybody else? There is no act which governs the Intelligence Bureau. It has no constitutional safeguard. There's no charter. There's no mandate. Well, it used to be the same for the MI5 in the US, in the UK up to the 1980s. But in the 80s, they brought it under a legislation. Now, after the emergency, and that's the interesting part we should speak about, and you've mentioned that in your book, and I wanted to draw you out on that later. But during the emergency, and after the emergency, there was a Shah Commission which was set up. The Shah Commission set up a subcommittee called the LP Singh Committee to examine exactly this. What is the legislation that we should have to govern the Intelligence Bureau and the others? What should be their mandate? They duly came up with the report. But by then, power had changed hands. Indira Gandhi came back to power, and the Shah Commission report and the LP Singh Committee report sort of just dwindled. You would have thought that when VP Singh came to power, he would bring this into power, into thing. When the coalition governments of the 90s, they would do something about it. It was not done for the simple reason that the Prime Minister finds it useful to have an instrument like the Intelligence Bureau under his control or her control. Just like how the Chief Minister of every state finds it useful to have the police under his or her control. It gives you political power and ability to look at what your political opponents are doing. This does not mean you'll win every single election, but it gives you some amount of power. So that is, I think, the lay of the land. And I think what Josie makes this argument about, you know, the acceleration or the intensification and the qualitative change in the misuse of state apparatus in the last 7 to 8 years. But what I want to give you an insight is this is not new. And that's why I started with the president of make-believe, right? These statutes existed. Many of these statutes still exist. Oh, by the way, I must tell you, how many of you have Bitcoin? Don't raise your hand. You know why? Because if the new Bitcoin legislation is legislated, they can come and arrest you for having Bitcoin without warrant, and it's non-bailable. Right? How does anybody like do this? I can just go and say you have Bitcoin, prove that you don't. I mean, how do you do that? I mean, if you want to arrest people for narcotics, they still have to put some white talcum powder in your house to show that you have some white powder there, right? I mean, if they want to frame you. But with Bitcoin, it's easy. So you two gentlemen, you know, I've seen you. It's been recorded. But please don't take such liberties anymore, right? So this is the kind of lay of the land, right? And in this kind of a situation, you have an intensification of what happened. Now, before we go into that, the Shah Commission and emergency. What's the difference between emergency and this? I was not around at that time, but you probably were.
I was a child, you know. So. No, I think the emergency was officially declared act, and if you look at the emergencies and their period of emergency, what you see is that there is a generation which is which was born and inspired and internalized the independence movement. They do not just give into they are ready to taste economic liberalization, you know, chase their dream houses and cars. They're actually Gandhians in many ways. And that is the power of the opposition that you see under JP. I think the one big difference to me is that when this era emerged, the opposition is mostly people who do not have much of Gandhian values internalized. And many of them, and most of them are corrupt. And the media barons are publishing newspapers because they can reach advertisements to your house, not news. Television channels are floated because they got mines and other business to obtain, and this becomes a means to influence politics. And journalists are so insecure of the corporate salaries that they draw that they don't want to lose their jobs. So it's a huge difference in terms of opposition. The evil is not... Evil succeeds when its opposition is weak, right? Evil doesn't always succeed if the opposition is right. So I am saying that the emergency collapsed, not because Indira Gandhi decided to give up, but a generation of Gandhians and people of that generation, they stood up. Officials, I'll tell you about this IAS officer. I don't know whether I have the liberty to take his name, so I'm not taking his name. He was holding a very important position in Delhi, and R.K. Dhawan called him up from Prime Minister's office saying that, have you arrested these people? Vajpayee is going to do a protest at the railway station. Arrest him, take him to jail, arrest these many thousand. So he called up the Tihar jailer and told him, look, you're going to get R.K. Dhawan's call and keep lying. Say that people are coming in. Yes, people are being brought in. And through the morning, they kept lying. So, and finally, when the official after a few days realized that he can't anymore lie, he just took a transfer and left India. He came back to India later. But I'm just saying that there are people within the system also who were standing up. But today what you see is that there is a generation of bureaucrats, police officers who do not have the reassurance that if they stand up to these bullies, they will have their career left. You look at the bureaucrats whose careers have been ruined by this regime. People like Rajendra Kumar, who used to be Arvind Kejriwal's secretary, president's Prime Minister's gold medal winner for being the best bureaucrat, and others. And whereas there are another set of officials who have been accused of murder, who have been accused of other criminal activities. You can see what's playing out in Bombay. They're continuing to have flourishing careers. So I think one of the difference is that I'm not talking the constitutionality of Indira Gandhi, you know, declaring it on paper and this not being declared on paper. One is the qualitative difference of the opposition. So many of us who were part of the mainstream, left mainstream newspaper, not because we didn't want to be part of it, but because we realized that there is no space for us. We came out to write our own books and try and find our bread in whatever ways we can. That's one thing. The second difference is that Indira Gandhi's entire rule was driven by her personality cult. But today, Mr. Modi has managed to mix the poison of religious divide deep into the society, injected it so deep that today it is far easier to implement authoritarian decisions across because of this entire religious poison that has been pumped in. And the divisions are so stark and clear. And I know I feel for many of my Muslim friends. I mean, I don't know how they live with, I don't think they have the dignity in the public space left anymore. I mean, you hear him every other day? I mean, Prime Minister of India talking about Aurangzeb and Shivaji and all that crap. I mean, it's what more can you get? So the difference is that many of us, I mean, I have a Christian name, but I don't go to church or I mean, greatly believe in institution of church. Many of us who believe that India remained a democracy in a region where it has been subverted and would flourish and become a mature democracy because of the liberal ethos of Hinduism and its diversity, we are being told that, look, man, you are all being foolish and naive because you don't need all the Hindus to be injected Hindutva poison. You only need a small concentrated group. So those are the differences to me. And the final thing is that even during emergency, the actions of the police or the agencies were there are number of arrests were much larger. But if you look at the the kind of cases, the kind of blackmail that happened were much smaller scale. You know, recently, I don't want to have another defamation case on me. One of our biggest airports recently changed hands. You should ask what happened, how CBI and Enforcement Directorate were pressed to service to warn the owners to transfer the ownership to the regime's favorite friend. So it's a different scale. And also because the markets are huge today, right? Those days, what was the market? So those are, to me, the qualitative and quantitative difference. I don't know if I'm...
Okay, so let's get into this a little further, right? Now, in this polarized environment, those of your readers, the people here who don't have sympathy for the, you know, for the BJP and Modi ji, will buy what you say. You know, it's like everybody feels that this is a real problem. We've got to fix it. This has become bad. This is all of that. And they'll, you know, nothing Modi ji says will convince them otherwise. But if you now have to appeal to the people who support the BJP, who are fond of Modi ji for one reason or the other, how would you make that message? What message would you give them? Because they would just say, hey, you know, this is, you know, Indira Gandhi did it, Nehru did it, so Modi ji is doing it. So
I would request them to read my book. Because
you see, you identified a deep problem. I have a deeper problem which I've identified. People don't read.
Yeah, that's something we can fix.
That's why Twitter is successful, right? So if you have to now...
That's also good for many of us, because if you look at the landscape of media, the only place where the government censorship doesn't work is publishing.
Because nobody reads.
Nobody reads, yeah.
No. But people here do read. And I mean, you have a house full amid COVID in a Bangalore lit fest. Obviously, people read. So Bangalore is an exception. The street
This is like 0.01% of Bangalore.
No, but these are the most important people in Bangalore.
Of course. Yeah. No, but on a serious note, non-fiction publishing is the only area of media where the government has not been really touched.
I mean, don't ruin it, boss. Don't tell them. No, but seriously, if you have to... Big sister also. By the way, so what would be the case? You know, I'm trying to see if you have to make a case, because there are patriotic people there. You know, there are people on the side of the BJP who are interested. They are nationalists. They are interested in India. They're not all bigots, right? They're not all fond of, you know, some political cult or whatever. They are genuine people. How would you reach out to them?
See, it's very simple. He's not building a Hindu Raj. He's not bringing back a glorious past. He's an autocrat. And like all autocrats, they will misuse laws and agencies to hold on to power. And in that process, whether it's a Mr. Pai or a Joseph who stand on the way, we don't get discriminated, boss. Both of us will end up in jail. So your upper caste Hindu existence don't matter. And in my book, that's one of the things that I established. In fact, many of the victims that I paint in my book are privileged upper caste Hindus. And many of the biggest victims of this government are upper caste and Hindus. So we should not kid ourselves. And that's what I would tell them. Look, it's not about Modi or Indira Gandhi or Rajiv Gandhi or Narasimha Rao. It's about the world's greatest social and political experiment in the last 70,000-80,000 years since we left African shores. Such a complex society agreeing to live under a return law is, I think it's a miracle. And I think it's all of us need to strive to save that miracle for future generations and to showcase to the rest of the world that this is possible. And I don't think that Modi understands the power of that miracle. I think he has always, and if you look at him, not just Modi, many of the Indian political leaders, especially across the board, they all come up with their very skewed sense of India. I mean, their sense of India is very skewed and embarrassing. So we as public, we need to fight back. We need to reclaim those spaces. Otherwise, our children will be asked those kind of stupid questions in class and papers.
My daughter took that exam. And I can tell you that it had the opposite effect on her. So I think there's extremely, you know, somebody in CBSE who has extremely deep psychology. So if you put this kind of an answer paper there, everybody will be so pissed off that you achieved this whole business. I'm joking, of course. I'm being flippant, but I think that was a serious, serious affront. I mean,
yeah. So when you let, and the idea of India doesn't belong to any of them. It belonged to we the people. And if we, and many of us are people who could have left this country and had better careers outside, but we decided to stay back. And many here would have come back to India to stay here and enjoy this, because there is so much more humanness and openness and affection and love and celebration of life here than any other country in the world. And who the hell should be allowed to hijack this? Whether he's a Hindutvavadi or a Islamic leader or a Christian leader, who are, we don't care. I mean, we don't need to care about it. We just need to be bothered about the fact that the progress of a society is a very complex, slow-moving vehicle. And when leaders emerge because of the cracks in our systems, instead of putting them in jail, we allow them to become leaders. They come in and subvert that progress. And when that progress is subverted, coming generations and their ability to dream widely and is ruined. And they're you know, when you pick up a Disha Ravi from Bangalore and take her to Delhi, you know what parents like you and me are telling our children? Listen, you can post anything on social media, but nothing but politics. You know, when Brigadier Glidden dies, his daughter, instead of grieving, she's forced to delete her Twitter handle. Right? And I think this city of Bangalore, understands the power of dreams more than any other city. So I don't need to say much more about why we need to fight to take back the idea of India.
That's very nice. Let's move to a different part of it. And part of the book, when I read it as an analyst, you know, and this is mainly about the cover. The cover says deep state, silent coup. You know, the idea of a deep state is something for a student of statecraft, and sometime at some point also part practitioner of statecraft. It appeals to me because you need a deep state, especially in democratic societies, to keep that constitutional structure moving forward. You know, the basic structure of the constitution should continue to exist regardless of who's a particular person in power, what are his or her, you know, likes, dislikes, intelligence, in terms of intelligence, not about intelligence, and so on, right? So you need a deep state which keeps it together. And every good functioning state has one. The UK has it, the United States has it, India has it, Pakistan has it, but unfortunately it has the wrong kind of deep state inside. So the fact that a deep state exists, and this has members of the administrative apparatus, the security apparatus, the defense, the legal and the judicial apparatus, they keep this together. In a way, a republic is just a drama, no? Everybody has a role. As long as they play that role, the republic continues. If somebody drops doing that role, it doesn't. So what in this set of stories that you tell in the book, which you don't, I mean, I love the fact that you allowed us to keep our memories in line. You know, what happens is because of social media, you jump from one story to the other, you know, by the time to them come to the fifth story, you've forgotten what actually happened yesterday or day before yesterday. So the book, you know, gives you an entire story from at least from a particular point till today. That's wonderful. But what makes you say that it's a silent coup? You know, what a coup usually means that, you know, it's an overthrow of the regime, right? Of the state.
Yeah.
Is that happened?
Two things. One is the definition of deep state that you said, which is a hidden secret apparatus of people with permanent stake in the system, who are not connected to the political ruler of the day, usually, who are either trying to protect the republic or subvert it. Both can be deep state, right? But those are definitions that you and I learned in our academic years from the Western frameworks. I am saying that we need to look at Indian framework, because our democracy is far more complex, far bigger, far more exciting and academically robust than any Western democracies. Yes, West has great liberal artisans, teachers, professors who created these frameworks, keep writing books. So we are also in many ways intellectually, I won't say slave, but influenced by those definitions. But I'm saying that no, to me, a deep state is that part of the state which is not visible to us as a whole. right? And if you look at the non-military security establishment of India, that is a monster out there. You don't see it as one, because when the income tax goes to Akhilesh Yadav's office to raid yesterday, we say, oh, income tax is fighting the UP elections. But no, it is deep state sending one tentacle out there, because the political master has given orders. You send the first tentacle, then the second. So to me, the deep state as a word, and I knew that this question will emerge, and having studied some amount of political science, I knew that this is going contrary to the definition that we have all discussed. To me, the deep state, we need to be very clear. Deep state is any force, any network that threatens democracy as defined by our constitution, right? That's why I use the word deliberately. In fact, my original title of the book was The Business of Terror, etc. And then it was my editor, Rajita, and I don't know if she's around. The silent coup. I think so. I think the coup has taken place. You are the head of a very reputed, respected think tank. Can you honestly tell me, on your own, without anybody's reference, do you have the courage to walk into a police station in this city?
In this city? Yes.
Why?
Bangalore, I think that's why we are. Why are we in Bangalore? Why is the reputed think tank in Bangalore? Because we can do that.
I'm sorry. I don't have the power. I don't have the courage. I'm a journalist who has covered police, and I know a lot of IPS officers. I don't have the courage to walk into a police station, even for something that is rightfully mine, without reference from a police officer or without somebody putting in a word in advance saying that I'm coming. No, we should disagree. That's what democracy is about.
No, I think it's because of experience. And Josie, I'll tell you this. I have encountered this conversation, this police-related thing in many other contexts. I think in most people who tell us this, I mean, maybe we are living in a bubble called Bangalore and bubble of privilege, because, you know, when people in this room go to a police station, I think you do get a hearing and, you know, you can be, I mean, they might not take action and catch, but at least they'll give you a hearing and they'll listen to you. This might not happen in other parts of the country. And that's something which we in Bangalore have to preserve, whatever happens, right? But you're saying that in most other parts of the country, it won't happen? Or are there specific states and places where this isn't happening?
No, we can dissect. You know, for example, there was a time when magazines like India Today would foolishly say that Kerala has got the highest crime rate.
because you count.
Because they count also. Because in Kerala, even road accidents have to be an FIR. So that's we can keep arguing. But the fact is, I'm a privileged, we belong to the elite, right? When I'm saying that I am afraid, imagine the plight of the poor. And I didn't mean that I'll take care of myself. But what I'm saying is that imagine the poor of that poor Dalit, that poor Muslim. Every other day in some part of the country, somebody is being killed in torture, in police custody. I don't know how many police stations in this country do not have torture chambers. And I don't know which law enables, authorizes them to set up soundproof torture chambers. In fact, in my first part of the book, I write about the ATS, anti-terrorism squad in Bombay, and their torture chamber. I mean, which law gives an ATS the power to set up the torture chamber? I don't know. I'm just saying that. So democracy, if it is a contract between a state and its citizens, or if it is collectively owned by we the people, I think there is something broken out there. Because across police, I mean, you saw what happened in Nagaland the other day. Can you tell me, as someone who knows that part of the world, what happened? Do you think a paracommando force does operation like that? I can tell you what happened. They were taken for a royal ride by some source who told them. And that source, who, at what level is the source mixed up, is my question. And that's what I keep saying in my book. My argument is about this entire informant industry. So I am saying it's broken. The contract is broken.
But why is it a coup? A coup implies that these guys can actually make laws which will then affect our lives. Right now, these guys are still servants of the political masters who are politically elected by the majority. First past the post, it's all fine. But the person who's been elected is the duly elected leader of the country.
Oh, so what happens is, Nitin, in a large country like ours, the leader only needs a few people and he has got only a few targets to fix. But when an agency's boss is doing the fixing of threatening the airport owner to sell it to somebody else, his junior is coming to threaten one of us to extort money. And you know, I don't know if you've been watching Enforcement Directorate, for example. In the last 10 years, under Prevention of Money Laundering Act, they have carried out 1,500 raids. Only 7 cases have been settled. In 6, there have been convictions. So ED will say, you know what, we got 95% conviction rate. I would say, no, you got 0.06% conviction or maybe 0.4% conviction rate, because you don't want the other cases to be closed by the courts because you were just intimidating somebody or faking something, right? Enforcement Directorate has had evidence where people, officials and their agents would create fake notices and extort money and then they will destroy the files. So there is a complete breakdown of the system. CBI, the real effective conviction rate is 3%. Jails, what is a conviction rate? It's again 3-4% of the inmates end up getting convicted. I'm not very sure of the number. Into that system, you are a sarin gun, not because it's Shah Rukh Khan's son. You send a youngster into that jail. Your system is broken. You are sending, you are arresting some of our brightest people and sending them into enclaves where democracy and law doesn't exist, the broken systems. You have agencies where the success rate tells me that actually we would be better off without those agencies. So if this is not a coup, what is a coup? We don't need tanks on the road to be a coup. I mean, that's a very old style, right?
I think on that note, I think we should bring the audience into the conversation. We don't need tanks on the road to be a coup. Traffic is good enough.
Yeah. I think we have...
Do you think the judiciary is also complicit in the process?
Oh, yeah, it is. It is high time. Our judiciary has really been, at one point of time, Indian judiciary was a globally celebrated institution, especially the lower judiciary for the way it held prime minister accountable, etc. But I think today judiciary is in deep crisis. Deep crisis to the extent that some of our finest judges at the High Court are not even allowed to come into Supreme Court or sit as Chief Justice of this thing. So at the Supreme Court, there are enough murmurs about courts and judges, and our Supreme Court judges, at least the you know, they should come down from their high pedestals and look at and listen to the public and realize that you are part of the road, like the media is.
But Josie, they also have skeletons in the cupboard.
That's a problem. See, when in an immoral society, all of us have skeletons in the cupboard. So we are all in this silent conspiracy of silence, right? When the Prime Minister's office sent summons to the Chief Election Commission of India, you quietly attend the meeting, man. You know, I don't know if how many of you have been to the UPSC headquarters. There used to be a photograph of Nehru calling on the UPSC vice chairman, right? He's called the vice chairman of UPSC, UPSC chief. The Prime Minister of India calling on him, that was a level of dignity that those officers enjoyed. Today, PMO summons CEC. I mean, that's where it is. So judiciary and constitutional institutions are definitely part of our problem. Lower judiciary is so deeply corrupt and flawed that, I mean, it's miserable out there. We need complete overhaul of judiciary.
Thank you.
No, first, I want to start with disagreeing with the police station part. In last 1 month in Karnataka, 2 people have been killed in a police station lockup torture. 2 have been made to drink urine. I don't think that is anyway reassuring in the situation. A question to you, sir. First is about Wajid, the character that actually builds the book. Is it some special story that came to you and that you built on it, or there were many stories where you picked Wajid? Are there many more Wajids currently available? And second question, sir, just quickly. Second is regarding, you said, I'll just finish up. The second question is regarding, you specifically mentioned in your book that we don't have any system to check the intelligence input that arrives. Like the recent encounter that happened seems like a result of such a thing. Any steps, anything has happened over a period of it still continues to be the same. Two questions.
Wahid was a character I came across because I was, it's one thing to make a claim in an academic paper or an op-ed piece about the subversion, another thing to write a book. So I had to find a character who has documented his experience in the torture chambers and with the police officers in a court of law, because I've named some senior, very famous IPS officers. In fact, recently a movie came out with the same officers by a surname. So Wahid and his cohort, that group of about a dozen people who were accused of 2006 train blast, they're extremely courageous people. because they kept filing, recording everything in the trial court, torture that they face, because they believed in the system more than anyone of us. And Wahid continues to believe in the system because he runs an innocence network. So I was looking for that character. Second, and very honestly, I'm telling you this, I wasn't looking for a Muslim who has been victimized because of some Hindu doing wrong. I was looking for a genuine case where a Muslim has been jailed for another Muslim's doing. So I thought that tells a story. Your second question was about, no, there is no external audit of intelligence information that's flowing in. And that has become a serious problem. If you look at the last 10 years of Kashmir, 10, 15 years, many of the senior military officers killed there are all victims of flawed intelligence information. Military won't, army won't accept it. I am saying this with courage and confidence because I know how the finally many of the CEOs landed up at the encounter sites. Because some VIP informant will call up saying that, you know, there is a militant hiding. And twice you get the information, you go and eliminate the militant, come back. Third time, you are 100% confident that the same source is right. But the third time, the source is sending you to your certain death. And that's what's happening in Kashmir. We have not been paying attention. Army, Intelligence Bureau, RNDW, and other agencies, they are more bothered about the turf than about improving and protecting their own men.
All right. On that note?
On that note, we should end. I just want to end it on this note. See, one of the hidden strengths of any democracy, especially our democracy, is an ability to self-correct. So it's a pendulum which swings, and that sometimes it swings to an extreme, which also means it's going to come back. So I want to leave us this afternoon with an optimistic note that once you have documented such stark and extensive and deep miscarriages of justice, I think the swinging back of the pendulum of constitutionalism is not too far away, because societies do self-correct. And it doesn't happen automatically. It happens because all of us do small little things in our lives, which moves the pendulum. You know, it's a small little thing. It could be a response to a WhatsApp message. That's probably enough to help move that pendulum. And to the extent that we can do these things, I think we should just do them.
Awesome. That's great. Thank you, Nitin.
We'll see you again.
We'll have to wrap it up.